This is Matthew Kratter from Trader University, and today I want to answer the question, is the United States already socialist? If you want to understand how the economy actually works so you can make money in both bull and bear markets, or you just want to see what I'm trading or investing in, be sure to hit that subscribe button. So there's been a lot of debate in the comment section of my videos lately about capitalism and socialism and these sort of things, so I wanted to give you my thoughts. It's obviously a very big question. The standard definition of socialism is social ownership of the means of production. Now, this is sort of Marxist jargon. We need to translate it. When people say social ownership, what's usually meant, at least historically is meant, is government ownership of the means of production. And rather than being owned by everybody, it's really owned by a small group of people. Means of production is sort of Marxist jargon for factories and this sort of thing. It's hard to know in the era of code and software whether this really makes sense. It does make a certain amount of sense. There's obviously capital, there's labor, there's people who own companies, and there's people who work at those companies. But this is kind of the classic definition of socialism. I don't think we have this. For example, I can buy shares of Apple or Tesla. I can actually have ownership in the means of production in that way. So I don't think we have that sort of socialism. There's another facet of socialism, which is this idea of central planning or a command economy. There are lots of little minute distinctions we can make here, but the basic idea is like in the Soviet Union, the USSR, government decides how much wheat to plant, how many shoes to make each year, etc. And as we'll see, we do have central planning in the US. I'm going to cover that in a moment. Another facet of socialism would be increasing reliance by individuals on the government for essential services, for food, for healthcare, for education. I've always thought public schools is a misnomer. They should actually be called government schools. But we certainly have this, and if anything, it's increased over the last decade. It certainly increased a lot in 2020, in major part due to COVID, but it's hard to know whether COVID is sort of a cloak to increase this sort of socialist aspect of our economy and to increase government power. But that is what has happened. The corporations, the large corporations, have become more powerful, and the government has taken over more services. Now, in a sense, this is good. We don't want people to starve. We don't want people not to have health care. But it is a sort of form of creeping socialism. There's a Zero Hedge article here. A quarter of all personal income as of the end of August 2020 now comes from the U.S. government. And a lot of this money is obviously just printed and sent out. Now, it's strange because we have this something that sort of smacks of socialism, but we also have something that smacks of kleptocracy. And these often go together. You have rule by oligarchs. We have the modern tech oligarchs who run these sort of monopolies and are not really regulated, ruled by Zuckerberg and Bezos and Walmart. Amazon, sort of the new version of Walmart, where you have a lot of people who don't make a living wage. All the people who work in the Amazon factories and who work in delivering the packages to your door, you have this strange thing where Bezos and Zuckerberg can continue to get more and more rich, and yet the employees are not sharing, obviously not sharing to the same percentage in this increase in wealth. And so this was the classic thing with Walmart that Walmart's been criticized for years, is that the employees don't make a living wage. And so the government has to step in and make up the difference with, you have a lot of people, employees of Walmart going on food stamps and this sort of thing. And so it's a strange mixture of socialism plus unregulated kleptocracy. And obviously people who have a lot of money can have a lot of say in the political process and can pay for lobbyists and can sort of get their way. Now, I want to zero in on this, what you could call Soviet type of economic planning or central planning. The jargon for this is STP, Soviet type economic planning. And this is basically how Marxist-Leninist states, socialist states like the USSR were run. Now, in a centrally planned economy, you have these sort of top-down orders about how much wheat to plant, as we said, how many shoes to manufacture. In the USSR, this institution was called Gosplan, that did all these, that made these economic decisions. And as we saw with the Soviet Union, it's very difficult to get this right what practical experience has taught, what the 20th century taught certainly, was that free markets and a fluctuating price, where you have this price as a means of communicating information about consumer preferences, this is a much better mechanism for ensuring that the grocery stores stay stocked and that there's supply and demand match up. There's this great article, which I'll link to, about Soviet shoes and about how people in the USSR used to sign up these very long lines. The longest lines in Moscow were to pick up shoes. And this guy did a little research and realized that this was strange, because it turns out that the Soviet Union at this point, I think this was the late 80s, right before it collapsed, the Soviet Union was the largest global producer of shoes. They were producing 800 million pairs of shoes a year, which was twice as many as Italy, three times as many as the United States. It was enough. It was more than three pairs of shoes for every Soviet man, woman, and child. But the problem was not the quantity of shoes, but they weren't comfortable, they didn't fit right, they didn't have the right style, etc. And so people were willing to stand in very long lines to get imported shoes. And those foreign shoe companies knew what people wanted, because they were operating according to a free market system, or at least a more free market system. This is Gosplan, the state planning committee in the USSR for central economic planning. So that's basically, that is, we all have this sort of idea, at least Americans do, that centrally planned economies don't work very well. And it certainly helped to lead to the collapse of the Soviet Union. But what I'm going to suggest in the U.S. is that we have central planning at the very heart of our economy. And a lot of people don't notice this, but once you see this, it's very difficult to unsee. Now, we know that money is the most fundamental type of good. People are willing to exchange almost anything for money. And these type of economic goods are called monetary goods. Examples of money might be the US dollar, gold, Bitcoin, etc. Now, I would suggest that since this is the most fundamental economic good, why in the world would you ever want to allow this to be centrally planned if you're against central planning? It turns out that it is money in the US is centrally planned. And because the US dollar is the global reserve currency, the world reserve currency, this has international implications. The Fed is like Gosplan for money. They control the supply of base money. They control the monetary base through quantitative easing, money printing, all these euphemisms. They also control the price of money, which is just interest rates. They control the front end of the yield curve by adjusting the Fed funds rate, which is now very close to zero. And they've increasingly begun to control the price of money further out the curve, at the five-year treasury level, the 10-year treasury level, corporate spread level. They've been buying junk bonds. And this is called yield curve control, when they try to keep, for example, the 10-year note yield below a certain price. So we have a case here of central planning at the center of the economy. You can just Google news about the Fed and you'll see, you know, the Fed has in Russia and the Soviet Union and China were very famous, especially in their super communist years, for having these five-year plans. Well, the Fed has a five-year plan or a three-year plan to keep interest rates near zero through 2023. This is all centrally planned money. They also have a central plan for inflation targeting. They're going to focus more on average inflation prices rather than average inflation rates rather than the absolute inflation rate. So if inflation rate has been, which is the CPI is a ridiculous manipulated number, you can see in some of my other videos, but if the inflation rate as measured by the CPI or one of these other measures has been low for a while, maybe it's been around 1%, they'll now let inflation run a little bit more hot. Maybe they'll let it run at 3 or 4%, and so the average will still be 2%, but they'll be less strict here. So you have an example here of central planning at the very heart of the U.S. economy. And I would suggest that you cannot have a truly capitalist economy when the most important good in that economy, as we said, which is money, is centrally planned. And I don't know why we tolerate the central planning of money, probably because most of us go to government schools, i.e. public schools, where they just don't teach this sort of thing. They teach, if they're going to teach economics at all, even at public universities or private universities, they'll teach some absurd Keynesian version of economics, but we do tolerate the central planning of money. And I wonder why we think that central planning, it's a really bad idea. There's this sort of general American consensus with this history of failures. North Korea, USSR would be the classic examples, and some of the Soviet, the old Soviet satellites. But then why do we allow central planning to go on at the very center of our economy? Why do we allow these 12 people on the Fed, especially one person named Jerome Powell, to have so much power and to be able to make these decisions? Why shouldn't these decisions as well be made by a free market? Why shouldn't the interest rate, the price of money, be set by supply and demand rather than being centrally manipulated? And I think this is one reason that I've been so interested in Bitcoin and recently DeFi, which stands for decentralized finance. Bitcoin was certainly the first really mainstream form of decentralized finance, but it's to sort of find a way to drive a wedge between money and the government, the federal government and the central bank. And you can debate about whether the central bank is private or public. There are a lot of semantics involved. But what we do know is that we have a centrally planned money supply, and it's not it's an authoritarian center that controls it all. In the U.S., we're famous in the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, for separation of church and state. I would suggest it's time to have separation of money and state, to try to find a way to drive a wedge and to drive out central planning from the heart of the U.S. economy. So I think, to conclude, in this sense, America is already socialist. We've been socialist since 1913, in that we've allowed a bunch of bankers like Jerome Powell, who have all these connections to Wall Street. He used to be a private equity guy, investment banker guy, and to allow a very small group of people like this to centrally plan the most essential good in the economy, which are monetary goods. If you enjoyed this video or found it helpful, be sure to hit that subscribe and like button. Hit the notification bell so you'll be notified when I publish my next video. And let me know your questions and comments in the comment section below. Thanks a lot for listening, and I'll see you in the next video.